Hello and welcome to the third and final podcast in the series looking at NHS continuing care. Joining me once again is Senior Solicitor Nick Endine from our community care team. Hi Nick.
Hi.
If you've not listened to the first or second podcast, then I would suggest that you do. The first podcast acts as an introduction to the NHS continuing care, what it is, and the general rules of eligibility. The second podcast covered the assessment process and what to expect. Our final podcast in this series looks at what can be done if you do not agree with a decision that has been made regarding eligibility for NHS continuing care and how to challenge this through the appeals process. All the podcasts are designed to give listeners a general overview of this complex and often emotional process. Every case is different, of course, and individual circumstances will require specific advice, and we would urge anyone listening to contact the community care team if you have a question for a no-obligation discussion. In the previous podcast, we talked about the multidisciplinary team meeting and completion of the decision support tool. Once the professionals have considered all of the domains and the key indicators, what happens next?
Yeah, the nurse assessor at the MDT, the multidisciplinary team meeting, would make a recommendation to the clinical commissioning group, or CCG. CCGs are ultimately responsible for the final decision, and they make the decision as to whether someone is eligible for NHS continuing healthcare. The MDT will make a recommendation. People may or may not be privy to that. It will depend on that particular circumstance. The recommendation will either be accepted, if everyone is in agreement, or reviewed by a panel before a final decision is reached. As I said, you may be told about the recommendation at the end of the MDT, but that's not always a given. Once a decision has been made, it will be communicated to the applicant or the applicant's representatives, so that'd be the patient's representatives, as soon as possible. The national framework states that the time between that initial checklist assessment and the final decision on eligibility should not be any longer than 28 days. I would be surprised if CCGs were able to stick to that deadline. There's quite a lot of delays at the moment with that process, but they will respond in writing and you'll get a copy of the decision support tool and a rationale for their decision-making process.
So what are the options available if you don't agree with the decision that's been made?
So the national framework again helps here, as it sets out an appeals process that has to be followed if you wanted to challenge any non-eligibility decision. The first stage is a local appeal, and that's the opportunity to discuss concerns that the applicant or the applicant's family have with the clinical commissioning group as well. They will look at the panel decision, if it went to panel, or the MDT recommendation in more detail. And the framework tells us that you should notify the clinical commissioning group of your intention to challenge the decision within 6 months of the date of the decision letter was communicated from you.
Thank you. And who's involved with a local appeal?
This will vary from CCG to CCG, but crucially, you will have the opportunity to attend and meet with at least one person from the CCG. In some cases, a CCG will put together a new panel, whereupon you can present your case to a representative, and that representative then puts it to a new panel, or it will just be listened to by a new person within the clinical commissioning group. They will then revisit the decision, look at the decision support tool, the checklist assessment, the evidence that was put across to the MDT, and so forth.
Tell us about the local appeal process. Are there any guidelines on what to expect?
You should expect a face-to-face meeting. That is quite a common approach for clinical commissioning groups. That keeps a kind of transparent approach. But sometimes they will offer a telephone appointment. Sometimes it can be quite difficult for representatives to be able to come face-to-face. And again, a lot of CCGs want to try and comply with quick turnaround time to be able to help families understand the decision that they've made. It's a relatively informal meeting and will be just around a table with representatives speaking with someone from the clinical commissioning group. Sometimes the CCG may consider it necessary to undertake a local review of the decision, especially if you've brought to the table some new evidence that perhaps was missed at the MDT. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes perhaps the MDT has been called a bit too early, or been changes or evidence that you weren't able to bring to the table at that meeting the CCG at the local appeal can look at that and have a complete local review, and that can result in either the original decision being upheld or, if the evidence is supportive, a new decision being reached. They also may decide, however, that the decision remains valid even if you have given them new information which wasn't considered by the MDT.
Thanks. If the local appeal is not successful, is there anything else that can be done?
There is, and the National Framework once again provides us with some guidance, and this is the second part of the appeals process. Once you've reached the end of what's called the local appeal and the Clinical Commissioning Group have communicated their decision, you have 6 months in which to lodge an appeal with NHS England asking them to convene what's called an independent review panel, or an independent review to convene a panel.
And what's the difference between this and the local appeal?
So NHS England will review all your concerns and they'll look at the entire decision again. If they are of the view, having looked at the papers, that the matter should be investigated, that then they will arrange for this independent review panel, or IRP, to take place. An IRP is quite similar in constitution to the local appeal, but as the name implies, it is completely independent to that of the Clinical Commissioning Group that you have been dealing with throughout this process so far. There'll be an independent chairperson, a representative from a different Clinical Commissioning Group, and a representative from a different local authority to provide those social care input. Neither of these people would have been involved with the case before and will only be judging it on the evidence presented by yourself and the Clinical Commissioning Group. There'll also be a clinical advisor who will be able to ask and answer any technical questions that the panel may have when deliberating. You'll be invited to attend the IRP, which will be convened by NHS England in one of their offices, and you can explain to them directly why you don't think the decision reached by the CCG was correct. The CCG will also be present and they will obviously explain why they believe that their decision was correct. Once the evidence has been presented, the panel will retire and that will be the end of the meeting, and they'll consider their eligibility decision accordingly. You normally get the decision in around 6 weeks' time after that.
And what are the possible outcomes of a IRP?
So the IRP will basically make a fresh decision on eligibility for NHS continuing care for the applicant. They'll either agree with the original CCG that the person was not eligible for funding, or disagree and state that that person should have been found eligible for funding. As a result, basically overturns the original decision supports order. The IRP, however, may agree with some of your arguments and you may see some domain weightings change, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the final outcome will change. It will entirely depend on the individual circumstances of the case.
Is there anything else that can be done if the family still do not agree with the outcome?
There is. Last and final stage that you could make is a complaint to the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman. They're not interested in the final decision per se, but how the decision was made by NHS England and the Independent Review Panel. If they consider there are sufficient concerns, they'll look at the process that was adopted by NHS England at the IRP stage and make a recommendation if they feel that the matter ought to have been dealt with differently. If successful, the Ombudsman will not overturn the eligibility decision itself, but will make a recommendation which ought to be followed by NHS England or the Clinical Commissioning Group for that matter to retake the decision, make the decision again, because they would have potentially failed to adhere to either procedural concerns or not take into account sufficient evidence that we raised to the Ombudsman. Finally, with regards to the Ombudsman, you have a year from the date of the decision letter from the Independent Review Panel.
Okay, and what if an appeal is successful? What does that mean for the individual?
Well, if an appeal is successful, either at local appeal or independent review stage, then it means the original decision was flawed, and therefore the new decision is treated as if the original MDT assessed the person as being eligible for CHC funding. In practical terms, this means that not only will the CCG take over funding responsibility for that person's ongoing care fees, but they'll also refund any care fees by the individual or the family following the original assessment. So any fees that they have paid since that time will be refunded. This payment also attracts interest, which is particularly important because in our experience appeals can take quite a long time to go through, and as a result there could be several years of care home fees to be repaid.
Thank you. It sounds like a challenging process to navigate. Do you have any words of wisdom for families who are going through this process?
don't give up. Firstly, I'd say that process can be difficult to navigate and you may feel frustrated, but care fees can be expensive and securing funding for your loved one can help to reduce financial worries for them at a difficult time. And, you know, many individuals are wrongly denied CHC funding. There needs to be, you know, full knowledge of the framework to understand the complex assessment process. We provide that full support and assistance at any given point of an application or appeal for CHC funding.
So when should anyone really be seeking some advice?
I would say as soon as possible, potentially even before any application for CHC funding has been made. We can assist at any stage, of course, not a problem at all. But the earlier the better avoids the need for lengthy and time-consuming challenges, especially on hospital discharge matters where they're looking to review people while still in the hospital. Or if someone is still in a care home, then earlier the better, because we can provide a free preliminary assessment on the merits of doing so. And, you know, we're happy to do that at any point as well. Equally, it's important if someone has been appointed as an attorney or deputy, they have a duty to consider how care is funded as to not to waste that person's assets. So it should always be on the forefront of people's minds if they're in a legal position to make best interest decisions.
Thanks again, Nick, for providing us with so much vital information on such an important topic. It is good to know that families are not forced to accept a decision that they do not agree with, and that there are procedures in place to allow them to discuss their concerns so effectively. If you think that a loved one may be eligible for NHS continuing care, then please contact Nick or anyone in the community care team via the website or using the contact details on screen. The community care team will guide you on the prospects of making a successful claim and offer a free initial assessment at any stage of the process. That wraps up our podcast series on NHS continuing care. If you missed any of the earlier podcasts on this topic, they are still available on the Morblatch website. I would like to thank Nick for joining us today and hope you can join us for future podcasts.